I'm going to speak in English about what's going on in Cuba because I don't hear a lot of English speakers talking about this and my generation talking about this. Cuba has been under a dictatorship for 62 years.
How many do you give?
I think it's zero.
Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is not your normal politician. At 29, she's the youngest woman ever elected to Congress. And she's taken D.C. by storm. So why is AOC, as many now call her, the newest political figure everyone loves?
Do you call yourself a radical?
Yeah, you know, if that's what radical means, call me a radical. The world is going to end in 12 years if we don't address climate change. This is our World War II. This is our World War II.
That as you climb up this ladder, you should be contributing more.
President Trump and many conservatives have a word for that, socialism.
She's a socialist, she wants 7% tax rates. Those are both accurate, right?
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay.
About what's going on in Cuba, because I don't hear a lot of English speakers talking about this, and my generation talking about this. Cuba has been under a dictatorship for 62 years. So, people, for the last 62 years, since 1960s and 1958, around there, people started making homemade boats that we call lanchas and have bringing them to the coast of Florida seeking shelter. Let me explain to you why, because you might be saying, well, they're just immigrants invading because they want to leave their home country. No, it's because us Cubans, we don't complain about anything. It takes a lot for us to complain. And this, I'm sick and tired of it. So let me tell you what's going on. There's no coffins for dead bodies. If you have a dead family member, they get pronounced dead. They get wrapped in a bed sheet. You get delivered the dead body, and you have to take it home with you. What you do with the body, they don't care. You have to figure it out. If you don't have a car, they don't provide transportation, and you have to take the dead body home walking.
Democratic socialist.
Very different. Okay. Socialists believe in collective versus individual ownership. That collective can be the government, workers, or citizens.
So, people, for the last 62 years, since 1960s and 1958, around there, people started making homemade boats that we call lanchas and have bringing them to the coast of Florida seeking shelter. Let me explain to you why, because you might be saying, well, they're just immigrants invading because they want to leave their home country.
She's a socialist, she wants 7% tax rates. Those are both accurate, right?
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay.
Socialists believe in collective versus individual ownership. That collective can be the government, workers, or citizens.
I'm using the S word. Socialism,
yeah.
And socialist. It was a not too subtle, I don't know whether it's a dig or a enhancement. I'll let you decide.
I was flattered.
Okay, fair enough. You have said you are a democratic socialist.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Can you be a democratic socialist and a capitalist?
Well, I think it depends on your interpretation. So there are some democratic socialists that would say absolutely not.
For you?
I think it's possible. I think.
Do you say to yourself, I'm a capitalist, but?
I don't say that.
Okay.
You know, if anything, I would say I believe in a democratic economy, but.
Gotcha.
But. The butt is there.
Okay.
So it's not about government takeover.
Good morning, guys, from the Caribbean island of Cuba. We've ordered ourselves plates of spaghetti because it seems that here in Cuba, in these like traditional Cuban cafes, not for tourists, everyone eats spaghetti.
We've ordered ourselves plates of spaghetti because it seems that here in Cuba, in these like traditional Cuban cafes, not for tourists, everyone eats spaghetti. Because there's been an embargo on Cuba since Fidel took over, and so they have to like improvise. And so when you want a glass here, you chop off the bottle of a half a bottle of Corona. Do it like that. Spaghetti, tomato, ketchup, and cheese. That's this. And half a Corona glass of water. Super.
This is quite the cuisine. Good? Buenos dias! Viva Cuba! Up here on top of this building, if you can see it, is a Fidel Castro with a rucksack going off to war. Going off to slay some imperialists. The girl of Fidel. Hola, señor. Huh?
Nebo.
Nebo.
Let's see after that.
So this here is a picture you've seen 100 times on t-shirts, on walls. This is Che Guevara. So who was Che Guevara? Well, he was an Argentinian. Maybe you know this already, but I'm going to tell you again. But his name was not really Che. People think his name was Che Guevara. No. Why was he called Che? It's a nickname. Because in Argentina, where Che, or his real name Ernesto, was from, they use the word Che at the end of sentences. Like in English, we say kind of like A. And they say Che. And so, when he met Fidel and the Cuban revolutionaries in Mexico, waiting for the invasion, he was always using the phrase Che, Che, Che. So they called him Che Guevara. What's happening? Look at the buses here, just look like cages, like circus And this is the boat, called the Grandma, called the Babushka, basically. And that's the boat that Fidel and Che and Raul, they came from the Yucatan Peninsula to invade Cuba and to kick out Batista, who was the, and so, yeah, here he is. Che, amigo, means friend.
Jubilado, más o menos, están sobre $10, $11. Jubilados más o menos están sobre $10, $11, $12 al mes.
$200.
No, está loco. $12 al mes.
$200.
No, está loco.
¿12?
$13 o $14 al mes, tumbando. $13 o $14 al mes, tumbando.
¿Y qué tú puedes comprar de tu salario?
Nada, del mercado. ¿Qué vas a comprar?
Nada.
Yo era profesor.
Sí.
$60.
60.
Uf. Unos meses.
Y todos jóvenes quieren escapar de Cuba, ¿verdad?
Claro.
Claro.
Sí.
Muy difícil.
Vale.
It's a tough life here in Cuba if you're making $60 a bloody month.
I'm gonna speak in English about what's going on in Cuba because I don't hear a lot of English speakers talking about this and my generation talking about this. Cuba has been under a dictatorship for 62 years. So people, for naturally, for the last 62 years, since 1960s and 1958, around there, people started making homemade boats that we call lanchas and have bringing them to the coast of Florida seeking shelter. Let me explain to you why, because you might be saying, well, they're just immigrants invading because they want to leave their home country. No, it's because us Cubans, we don't complain about anything. It takes a lot for us to complain. And this, I'm sick and tired of it. So let me tell you what's going on. There's no coffins for dead bodies. If you have a dead family member, they get pronounced dead. They get wrapped in a bed sheet. You get delivered the dead body, and you have to take it home with you. What you do with the body, they don't care. You have to figure it out. If you don't have a car, they don't provide transportation, and you have to take the dead body home walking. There's no drinking water. Food costs $200. A pound of rice costs $200. You don't want to know how much a 10-pound one costs. My favorite part. Canadian dollars is the currency of Cuba right now. If you don't have family here in the United States to give you money, you have to figure it out. You have to figure it out. Because the only way you can get money in Cuba is if you get it sent to you by here. Oh, and here, it takes months to get to Cuba. They shut off their light and water at 7. As soon as the sun goes down, your electricity gets shut. Internet is shut right now worldwide in Cuba. That's why we're not getting any new news. But we have family there. Everybody's out on the streets right now, just the same way they were yesterday. They're out on the streets right now. There's no medication, there's no Advil, there's no antibiotics, there's no butterfly needles, there's no IVs, there's nothing. And now is when people are hearing the screams out of Cuba. I'm sick and tired of this dictatorship. And my whole life, when we visited Cuba, you could not say a word against the government.
What can we do is what people want to know. Number one, I hope that we will all be clear about whose side we're on. You don't have to even agree with anything I've said. What you should agree with is that people everywhere in the world, including 90 miles from our shore, should be allowed to go into the street, peacefully march, call for an end to dictatorship, and not have their head cracked open. By the way, no one in Cuba has guns except the military. So why are these repressive forces walking around with these rifles and people getting shot? By the way, no one in Cuba has guns except the military. So why are these repressive forces walking around with these rifles and people getting shot? They're shooting people that literally are unarmed. Should be able to do that, and we should be clear. We should be clear in our language. Call it for what it is. We should make clear nothing's going to change. There's not going to be any sanctions changed as a result of this. On the contrary, I hope the Biden administration will now announce they have finished their review of Cuba policy and everything that's in place is staying in place. To the extent we change policy, I hope we make it a top priority to allow the people of Cuba to have free, unfettered, and open internet access. And the technology exists to do that with a satellite-based system. We should put the best minds to work on getting that done, because if the Cuban people have free and unfettered access to the internet, the first thing the regime shut down yesterday was the internet. They can communicate with each other, and they can receive information and communicate with the world. 90 miles from our shores, we should be allowed to do that. For all of those who believe and have faith in the international community, and I still hold hope that one day it will work again, where's Spain? Where's the EU? Where are all these countries that for years have given cover and protection to the Cuban regime and condemned America? They should speak out clearly that what's happening there is wrong, that repression is wrong. We should rally that. We should use our position of strength and power in the world and our influence in diplomatic circles to make that happen. We should be clear in our language. We don't just condemn this tyranny, we condemn this communist, this Marxist, this socialist tyranny. Call it for what it is. I hope the president will be very clear with the regime in Cuba that we will not tolerate them encouraging a mass migration event, because I'm warning you, this is what they do. They've done it twice already. Things get bad and they say, look, if you don't lift sanctions, if you don't go back to the Obama era policies, if you don't get rid of the embargo, it's inevitable. You're going to have 50,000 people take to the ocean and head towards the United States. They've used that against us twice. They did it in 94, they did it in 1980 with the Mario Boatman. President Biden needs to be clear, whether it's through private channels or saying it publicly, be abundantly clear that we will treat the encouragement of mass migration towards the United States as a hostile action and act accordingly. And President Biden needs to be clear, whether it's through private channels or saying it publicly, be abundantly clear that we will treat the encouragement of mass migration towards the United States as a hostile action and act accordingly. That cannot be tolerated. I want to close with this. I recognize that most of the members of this chamber, most of the people here in Washington, and frankly, most of the people in the country, do not pay attention to Cuba on a daily basis. I get it. I really do. But if you're not following the issue of Cuba, you can be forgiven for not knowing that what we're seeing, what we saw yesterday, what we're seeing today, what's happened recently, none of this was started by politicians. It wasn't started by me. Wasn't started by anybody in Miami or in Florida. Wasn't started by any think tank in Washington. Wasn't even started by political activists inside of Cuba. You know who started what's happening in Cuba? Artists. Poets. Songwriters. Writers. Actors. Musicians. They're the ones who started it. The San Isidro movement. Because they came after them. And there's a song, a lot of people don't realize that there was a song that came out earlier this year. A song that, by the way, if you play in Cuba, you will go to jail.
And my generation talking about this. Cuba has been under a dictatorship for 62 years. So people, for naturally, for the last 62 years, since 1960s and 1958, around there, people started making homemade boats that we call lanchas and have bringing them to the coast of Florida seeking shelter. Let me explain to you why, because you might be saying, well, they're just immigrants invading because they want to leave their home country. No, it's because us Cubans, we don't complain about anything. It takes a lot for us to complain. And this, I'm sick and tired of it. So let me tell you what's going on. There's no coffins for dead bodies. If you have a dead family member, they get pronounced dead. They get wrapped in a bed sheet. You get delivered the dead body, and you have to take it home with you. What you do with the body, they don't care. You have to figure it out. If you don't have a car, they don't provide transportation, and you have to take the dead body home walking. There's no drinking water. Food costs $200. A pound of rice costs $200. You don't want to know how much a 10-pound one costs. My favorite part. Canadian dollars is the currency of Cuba right now. If you don't have family here in the United States to give you money, you have to figure it out. You have to figure it out. Because the only way you can get money in Cuba is if you get it sent to you by here. Oh, and here, it takes months to get to Cuba. They shut off their light and water at 7. As soon as the sun goes down, your electricity gets shut. Internet is shut right now worldwide in Cuba. That's why we're not getting any new news. But we have family there. Everybody's out on the streets right now, just the same way they were yesterday. They're out on the streets right now. There's no medication, there's no Advil, there's no antibiotics, there's no butterfly needles, there's no IVs, there's nothing. And now is when people are hearing the screams out of Cuba. I'm sick and tired of this dictatorship. And my whole life, when we visited Cuba, you could not say a word against the government. But now I can go to my country and say Dia Canel Singao. Fuck.
Ay, mamá, y esto es pa' dedicado pa' mi mamá. Y el que se ponga en contra, que se la vea con mi papá, cabio. Ay, mamá. Ay. Llora como yo lloré. Yeah. Llora como yo lloré. Llora como yo lloré. Llora como yo lloré. Está contento acabó el tambor, va a la escuela, niño, vamos a leer. ¡Hey! Soy cubana y quiero a Cuba, y muero por mi bandera, y le brindo esta canción de mi delirio.
Momento, que no se escucha.
Se acabó el tambor, va a la escuela, niño, vamos a leer. ¡Hey! Soy cubana y quiero a Cuba, y muero por mi bandera, y le brindo esta canción de mi religión santera. Mi madre es la cabecera, como la Virgen bendita. Todo lo que ustedes necesitan, desde un vaso de agua fresca que les limpie el corazón, hasta el alto magistrado que les dice el caracol. A la educación, señores, eso es lo primero que debe de aprender. Esa es la niñez, señores, la que está encargada
to intervene in Cuba. How exactly should we intervene and under what circumstances?
Well, thank you so much, Barney, for covering this. This is an issue that I think very much matters to the United States. You know, Cuba is one of the largest narco-traffickers in the region. It's a state sponsor of terrorists as designated by the United States, and it is exporting communism throughout the hemisphere and throughout the world, and has been doing it for decades. And that is something that should interest the national security of the United States. There's a variety of different ways that the U.S. can intervene. Obviously, this is a humanitarian crisis because, number one, the Cuban people have no food. Number two, they have no medicines and they're dying. And number three, the U.S. has intervened in Latin America in numerous occasions and has been very successful. Obviously, the number one hope is that the Cuban people will successfully be able to change the system of government themselves from within, either by through some sort of a public seizing of control of the country, or the military itself realizing that what it's doing to its people is a stain on the history of their lives, and that they should be on the right side of history. Failing all that, the United States has to really look at itself in the mirror and think about the options that it's exercised in the past. Like, and it's something that could have ramifications not just for Cuba, it could have ramifications for Nicaragua and for Venezuela, which is tens of millions of people in this hemisphere.